That's not till later. Okay, tomorrow at 5 o'clock p.m., there's free hot chocolate. We will need it. And donuts. So free refreshments tomorrow at 5 o'clock, just over at Founders Hall in the Noise Building. So come, we're celebrating World Day of Prayer. So come and listen to a few of our students offer prayers in different faiths and perhaps even some different languages. So to promote peace among our students, our community, the nation, and the world. So tomorrow at 5 o'clock. Also, Into the Woods continues tonight through Saturday. Get your tickets early because it's a sellout show. It's a terrific show. You don't want to miss it. You can get your tickets right after convocation across the hall in the ticket office. Also tonight, all of these the stuff on the stage is because there's an a cappella choir concert tonight with the Institute Choir here at 7:30. On Tuesday, there's a wind symphony concert at 7:30 as well, and then on Wednesday, there's a cadence and wind women's concert choir at 7:30 as well. So all of that and more, just check the schedule on Canvas or on the Stone College website. So please take out your phones, turn them off or silence them, put them away so you can enjoy today's presentation. We have a lot going on for you today. So don't forget, next week is Commercial Music Ensemble. Is anybody in here in that group or have friends in the group? You've heard them. I think they performed here last semester as well. They're a lot of fun. Okay, without further ado, please welcome Ane Unu and his group, The Hype Band. They're here to perform Sunshine, so please welcome Ane Unu.
Hello. It's weird. Okay. So we have this thing, we kind of change our name every performance. So today we are the Hype Band because we're hyping up Miss Ribeiro from Mozambique. I had the pleasure to meet her just before. She's a really nice lady. So, okay, here goes. Jesu anondi disisa ini. Jesu anondi disisa ini. Jesu anondida akandifira Jesu anondidisisa ini Jesu anondidisisa ini Unondipamanyemwe ehea Cheropatiri tese ehea Unondi pamanye mwe ehea Chero patiri tese Pa uno pamba uchipura Unoeta kungeshura Munu ese anocheuka Chenjera kuchkoka Ne mafambiro wa unoeta Unoeta kungebrita Ripare enga chikwikwiza Pamba iwe iwe
1, 2, 1, 2, 3.
Listen closer. Yo, I got a story to tell.
I was
walking all alone along some water.
I'm a person
that could change my life.
I think I met
the woman that could one day be my wife. Da noite moro,
moro.
Tu bohanzi soko.
Na
zona ziri yore. Wakanda maji shora yore. I said, girl, you are my everything, my sunshine. Girl, you are my everything, my sunshine. Girl, you are my everything, my sunshine. Girl, you are my everything, my sunshine.
You are Johnny Flavor, wonder favor, you're my favorite one.
You're my favorite one.
Baby, won't you come into my life?
You're the only one that makes everything right.
Girl, you are my everything, my sunshine.
Girl, you are my everything, my sunshine.
Girl, the trumpet, on the saxophone, and this tag on the vocal. Okay, now I don't wanna play no games. I've been out here taking names. I call you on your pager, won't do you any favors. Take you for a date. I might show up sort of late, but it's cool because my outfit coordinates. On a Monday, maybe on a Sunday, we could go to Subway. We could do it your way or my way. Maybe on a Friday, girl, you got the moves. You give me the sweet test that food.
Time for the Hype Band. Don't you love them? Don't you love this class? Yes. Okay, all right. Next, on to our amazing speaker, Natasha Ribeiro. Yes? Ribeiro. She was raised in Mozambique. She holds a bachelor's degree in forest engineering from UEM in Mozambique. She's very eclectic. She earned an MS in Management and Conservation of Biodiversity in Costa Rica and a PhD in Environmental Sciences from the University of Virginia, right here in the US. Natasha has more than 20 years of professional experience in teaching, researching, and extension in the field of forestry and forest fires ecology. She is the regional field of forestry coordinator of the Mayombo Network of Southern Africa, and she's here as a guest, as our guest, as part of the Fulbright Visiting Scholar Program, and she'll be giving another presentation tonight at 6 o'clock p.m. this evening on the culture and people of Mozambique. If you want to come and hear more about the people of Mozambique and her culture, it'll be tonight at 6 in the Huntsman Library Auditorium. So without further ado, please help me welcome Dr. Natasha Ribeiro.
Thank you so much, Celia. I would like to first thank the Snow College for inviting me for this short visit to the college. As you know, I speak Portuguese, so bear with me with my Portuguese accent, and I hope you will be able to follow my presentation, but I'm open for questions at the end. So today I'm going to be taking you to Southern Africa to talk about Some of the key factors in the ecology of our ecosystems, the Miombo woodlands, and I'll be talking specifically about fires, elephants, and human activities in the Miombo woodlands. So just for you to clarify what the Miombo woodlands are, it's probably new for most of you. So these are the largest dry forest ecosystems in the world. If you see the maps, the green area is the Miombo woodlands. And if you check this map, which is the world map, you can see the green areas are the dry forest ecosystems. And the Miombo woodlands is really one of the major in terms of its extension worldwide. So it occupies 2.7 million square kilometers in Southern Africa across 7 countries. And in Mozambique, it's probably out of date, this figure, but more or less 65% of the land is covered by Miombo woodlands. So why Miombo is important? It's not just because of its extension, but also socially and ecologically, this is a very key ecosystem in the region. So ecologically, it is highly diverse. We count an estimation of 8,500 plant species. Half of them are endemic or just specific for this region. And we have an important characteristic or uniqueness of this ecosystem, which is the disturbances, which mainly fires, herbivory, and people, which are key in determining the ecology and the dynamics of the ecosystem. And I'll talk about that later. Socially, Miombo is also very important for the people in the region. It supports the livelihoods of more than 160 million peoples, both at rural and urban areas. And people have been in the Miombo lands. The records count for 200,000 years ago when people arrived to the Miombo lands. So it's really a very old and interesting relationship between people and the ecology of the Miombo. So there's this really very tight relationship. So these pictures show some of the activities that are important for the Miombo ecology, and I'll talk about them later. The honey production, you can see a hive here. Charcoal production and slash and burn agriculture is also one of the main activities in this ecosystem. Talking about the two main, and which is the focus of this presentation also, two of these disturbance factors that are very important in Miombo. It's the relationship between elephants and anthropogenic fires. How this relationship works? So elephants, it's considered a keystone species in the Miombo because they maintain the ecosystem as a woodland, and if they are removed from the ecosystem can evolve to a more forest-like ecosystem. So they're really key in sustaining these Miombo woodlands. So basically, their behavior, they debarked trees, exposing inner tissues of the adult trees, but they also uproot some of the large trees, increasing the light to the forest ground, and then increasing the fuel load for fires. So fires, which are mostly anthropogenic when they come, with a higher fuel load, they become more intense and fiercer, so the impact they cause on the ecosystem can be negative. If the fuel load is lower, the impacts are not that negative. So that's the relationship that I've been studying in the last 10, 15 years, trying to address these relationships. So fires in Miombo, the records again show that fires have been in the Miombo, they arrived in the Miombo together with people, so they are very old disturbance in this ecosystem, and because of that, it's an important disturbance to maintain the ecosystem. Some species even depend on fires to regenerate and germinate their seeds. So there's a really important role of fires in the ecology of Miombo. And really, the fires in this ecosystem are basically anthropogenic, or People basically use fires for everything else they do on the forest, like hunting, honey production, slash and burn agriculture. All these activities use fire as a management tool. So it's really important. So the thing here, it's the fire regimes that are important to maintain the ecosystem. So if they change, when you talk about fire regimes, we're talking basically about the frequency and the intensity of fire. So if they change the frequency and the intensity of fire, they can then become, again, negative to the ecosystem. So this is an illustration of the effects of fire. So when I say frequency, so fires, when they occur every 2 to 3 years in the ecosystem, the ecosystem is able to maintain itself. So you get this kind of, usually they are ground fires. They don't get to the canopy and destroy and kill the trees. They just stay here in the ground. So they don't really affect the canopy of the forest. So with this, every 2 to 3 years, you get the ecosystem that maintains itself as a tall miombo. But if the regime changes and fires start occurring every year, which it does in some parts of the region, so you get this kind of shrub miombo, and also there's changes in the diversity of miombo associated with these changes in fire regime. So I'm gonna now talk about my own research in Nyasa National Reserve. This is the largest protected area of the miombo ecosystem in the whole region. So it has about 42,000 square kilometers. I put the extension in miles for your reference. So it's really a big conservation area. And it has been through a different history of management since the Civil War, since the colonial period, until the current days where the government is managing the reserve. And this affects also the activities, the conservation activities that are being done in this area. So what's important about the reserve, it's not because it's the largest conservation area in Miombo, but its biodiversity, it's really important. So 72% it's covered by Miombo. You have lowland Miombo, but also highland Miombo, which usually are evergreen forests. You have numbers in terms of elephant population, 20,000 animals in 2012. It was the largest in the country, but then due to poaching, illegal hunting, the numbers are currently very, very low, like 5,000. I usually tell this, I'm doing the research in Nyasa since 2004, and like getting into the reserve, the first thing I would see was an elephant or a family of elephants. And from 5 years ago to now, I go to the reserve, I go every year, and I don't see any elephants. So really 5,000 elephants, they are out in the bush, hiding from the hunters, the poachers, and it's really hard to see. And if you think about the role of elephants on the ecosystem, this can also change the ecology of the ecosystem. And as any other place in Mozambique, the conservation areas have people living within the reserve. So in Nyasa, we have 45,000 people living inside. And as I said before, they depend pretty much on the forest resources for their livelihood. So nutrition, medicine, income, everything comes mainly from the forest. In fires, we have produced, this is a recently published paper, so this is the fire regime. I'll talk about this in the next slide. So the causes of fires in the reserve, as I said, as a management tool, everything, every activity from the people causes fires in the reserve. But I would like to mention these, the routes to Tanzania, so that these are commercial routes to Tanzania in the north. So people walk like 2 to 3 days to get to Tanzania and exchange products. In those 2 to 3 days, they camp out in the bush and they have to set up fires to warm up, to keep the wildlife away. So in this case, the fires get uncontrolled, and this is one of the main causes of fires in the reserve. This is, as I said, one of the maps that we just produced recently, published in December last year, with a fire regime, characterizing the fire regime of the Nyasa Reserve. As I said, this is a key issue when you study fires. I won't talk about all results because I don't have much time, but I would like to catch your attention on this map. The red areas show places where the fire really happens every year. And remember, if it happens every year, it can affect the ecosystem. And these places is where the fire regime is the common fire regime for Miombo every 2 to 3 years. So when we look at the effects of these differences in the ecosystem, we found that this ecosystem, sorry, the graph is not very clear, but I think the message here is that there are different groups of species, plant species, associated with fire. You still have the Miombo species very well spread across the whole reserve, but in places with high fire frequency, you have the Combretacea group, which it's a family of plant tree species, which are normally fire resistant. And so places, the red areas in the map is where the Combretaceas occur. So these resistant fire species are taking over the Miombo species. So in the future, if the regime continues, the diversity and the composition of the Miombo can be affected. And if you think in the Miombo resources for local people, so the resources can also be changing in the future. So this is also showing the structure, not the composition, but the structure of the ecosystem, how it is affected by fires and elephants. And we found that the grass biomass is more related to fire frequency and elephant density, while woody component is more related to other factors such as topography, precipitation, and other environmental factors. Also, biomass is affected by fire frequency. These graphs show that our plots that were never burned, they have higher biomass comparing to plots that were burned more than once during our study period of 5 years. So, really, if fires continue to occur with changes in composition and changes in structure, Miombo in Nyasa Reserve can change from a sink to a source of carbon to the atmosphere, thus affecting the climate, the regional climate in this area. So when I say changes in forest composition and structure related to fire, this is what, in terms of pictures, what you can expect to see. So in these places with red areas, you have sparser trees and more grass component, while in places, in the yellow places and green places, you have a denser canopy composition and also less grass component. So you really can see the differences in terms of the structure, but also the composition, as I said. Okay, now going more onto the Miombo lands as a social ecosystem. As I said, the people depend pretty much on everything for their livelihoods, but not just their livelihoods. Miombo also support regional and national economies in terms of timber exportation and other products that are exported from the Miombo lands. But some figures show this, its importance. So like 76% of the energy used in the region comes from the Miombo lands. Like the numbers in terms of the medicinal plants in their in terms of incomes produced from the Miombo, and also in terms of the carbon sequestration, 18 to 24 pentagrams of carbon, which is very comparable with the tropical forests of the Democratic Republic of Congo. So it's very, very similar. So it, in terms of carbon sequestration, is still a very important service that Miombo provides to the region. So most of the activities are subsistence activities, like the daily domestic consumptive activities, mostly rural, like firewood, honey, land for agriculture, and building materials. If you see, this is a village, a rural village, and everything here, it's made out of the forest resources, so building materials are very important. But they also support, as I said, not just national economies, but also rural economies. They have support small enterprises, like this is a market, a rural market. You can see some building materials, some medicines, charcoal, and they are important to support the income of these people. So these are some important, I don't spend much time because I think my time is really short here, but some figures in terms of the importance of the Miombo woodlands in terms of charcoal production and how they provide support for the people in the region. So in terms of charcoal, this is a study we did in one of the northern provinces in an urban community. It shows that although they are people is, live in urban areas, they have access to electricity. In circles, you can see that they still depend on charcoal to cook. And they say here, you can see, they believe that cooking with charcoal is more efficient than cooking with electricity. This is to show that although people move sometimes to urban areas, they still depend on charcoal to cooking and warming up. So this is how does it work, the charcoal production process. So they select the species, usually adult species of certain species of certain plants that are very high calorific. So they cut these trees, they pile the trees of different sizes. You can see here you have adult trees, but you have also branches and small trees that are piled up for the kilns. One kiln like this can take 0.3 hectares of forest area to produce the kiln. So this is the kiln already prepared. It's sand and grass leaves that are piled up with the wood. And then it is left to burn for around 7 days. After 7 to 10 days, they take out the charcoal. This is a kiln after charcoal collection. And they transport in bikes, or if they can afford, they transport also in trucks to the main marketing centers, either along the roads or in main markets around the urban cities. What is not very well known is this process. If after the kiln is abandoned, if the forest recovers to a new forest, and how long does it take? So this is still a research area to be studied in the future. Here, just a figure that's important to know. I won't spend much time here, but like to do a kiln, that kiln that I just showed in the previous slide, it can take, as I said, 0.3 hectares, and considering the number of consumers in the urban and rural areas, so we estimated 40 square kilometers per year can be deforested to produce enough charcoal to the urban areas, but also the rural areas. So now moving into the honey gathering, which is a very interesting activity in Miombo. It's very linked to the ecosystem. So it's, as I said, it's important. It's especially important in periods of, when the agriculture crops are not high or due to drought or failure in crops, so they go to the forest and they collect honey to get as a safety net for their nutrition. Okay, so in terms of the process or the how do they do this is how it gets interesting, the relationship with the forest. So they do it through beekeeping. Here you see a traditional beehive, and through hunting, which is a process they go to the field, to the bush, and they select and they collect the honey. So beekeeping, it's very a very destructive activity. So basically, this picture shows that they take the bark of the tree, a cylinder. So basically, they kill the tree because they interrupt the circulation of the sap. And they leave the hive to dry for 2 weeks, and after that they put close to a place with some water, so some humidity, so the bees can colonize the hive, and then this hive can last for about 10 years or so, producing honey. So it's very selective. They have only 2-3 species that they use to produce the hives. And they get about 12 liters, 3 to 20 liters per hive. Usually one person has probably 4 to 5 hives around their houses. The other one is the honey gathering. As I said, they go to the bush and they go hunting for honey. And this is a very interesting relationship with this bird. It is indicator. It's called Zego. And what happens is that they go to the bush and they start whistling. And the Zego, he replies to the hunters, and they start walking together. The Zego, once in a while, they whistle and the Zego responds. And when the Zego gets to a tree with honey, he goes very frequently whistling. So the hunters know that that tree is the one with honey. So once they get there, they inspect the tree and they see if they need to cut down the tree or just collect in cavities. Basically, this is a cavity after being collected for honey, okay? And sometimes they fell the trees and they kill the trees to get the honey. These are some impacts of the trees. You get more tree mortality when you have high intensity honey collection. Slash and burn agriculture is another activity that it's really important in the Miombo ecosystem. Is basically, this is an area of Miombo. What they do, they usually set up the fire to clear up the area and make it easier to knock down the trees. So they, as you can see, they open up the area, knock down trees, they leave some trees up, usually shading trees and fruit trees that they don't kill because they need those trees for shading and for nutrition while they working on the field, on the farms. Then they open the farm and they cultivate for like 5 to 7 years when they abandon the area for more or less 10 to 15 years. And then this is a fallow after the cultivation. And after 10 to 15 years, you have like a Miombo woodland all recovered, okay, and ready to start the cycle again. Okay, so this is a cycle that allows the restoration in terms of nutrients in the soil and also, especially the nutrients of the soil, but also the diversity of Miombo. The main problem with slash and burn agriculture nowadays is the increase in human population, that these fallow periods have been decreasing from 15 to 20 years to less than 10 years. So the ecosystem doesn't have time enough to recover to a full ecosystem. So this is again effects of the slash and burn agriculture, but saying that after seven years to 10 years old, you can get a full recovered ecosystem. So one important thing about the Miombo lands in terms of restoring this ecosystem is that it's a very resilient ecosystem. I mean, you can, after agriculture, after timber harvesting, after charcoal production, if the ecosystem is managed, you can get in maybe 10 years, you can get, if well managed, you can get a very productive ecosystem again. So the studies in the region indicate 1.5 centimeters per year, which is the growth rate of Miombo species, the tree species, so which means in 10 to 15 years you can get a new. The problem is when you convert in terms of commercial agriculture, mining, and other activities that completely remove the productive material, so then you can hardly get the Miombo back. So, sorry, the pictures are not showing here, but basically here is to show that we really need to develop the region. We are poor countries in the region. We need to rely on the land to develop agriculture, commercial agriculture, and other activities. But at the same time, we have to consider that these woodlands, if they converted to other land uses, the people, the rural people, will lose the ecosystem services that are offered by these by Miombo land. So there's a need to be a trade-off between converting the land to other uses, but keeping at the same time the services they provide for this. So there's a need to engage in sustainable managing this ecosystem, which is very hard, and it's still very, very new and incipient in the region. There's very few cases in which the management of Miombo land is sustainable and allows long-term benefits, but we still need to work on integrated silviculture systems. For example, when you leave a land after charcoal production or after timber production, how do you manage that ecosystem to allow that the tree species grow very fast or faster than they grow? They will grow if they don't are managed. So there's a need to improve the forest management after they are selected for the main product. As I said, fire management is not done, basically not done in the region, not done in the region, yes, but not in Mozambique. And we need to work a lot on these activities of fire management. We need a lot of land use planning. We're still starting with that, with land use planning, where to allocate land for commercial agriculture, for conservation areas, for mining, without compromising the biodiversity and the ecosystem services provided by Miombo Woodlands. Also, there's a need because of all the global changes that are we are facing in the region and globally. These traditional practices sometimes, or most of the times, need to be adapted to the new conditions. Like slash and burn agriculture, we're now thinking if it's the right system to apply, or they have to change for a more permanent agriculture, which requires different resources. But how to change this from slash and burn to a more permanent agriculture? And of course, the policies and institutions need to be very strong and need to be still improved in the region to make sure that all these practices that we mentioned here are implemented and people get the benefit from all these activities. And with that, I would like to thank you. I hope it was clear enough for all of you. And I'm open for questions if we still have time. Thank you. One question? Yeah.
Are there like any alternatives? Because you said that people use a lot of the charcoal and stuff from the area. Mm-hmm. Are there alternatives? Is there an attempt to push alternative materials to not damage the
forest? Yeah, there's lots projects and intentions of giving alternatives to rural communities. Electricity is not an option because the network is very poor, as you know. But like improving the efficiency of the kilns, for instance, it's an alternative. It's within the charcoal production, but it's improving the efficiency of charcoal production. And other like dung and other alternatives. But really, I think people culturally are very attached to using wood as a source of energy. The few projects, at least in Mozambique, they didn't have very good results because people, after the project finished, the people go back to the wood and I must say, in the rural areas, they use more firewood. So they collect branches from the field. So charcoal is mainly for commercial purposes. They go to the urban areas or the roads to sell the charcoal. But at their homes, they use the firewood, which is not very destructive to the ecosystem. So, no questions? So, Cheryl? Okay, now, because I didn't say, but I've been collecting data in Nyasa Reserve for the last 12 years. I have permanent plots where I follow the dynamics of the forest. So we're now working on an ecological model to put this data together and simulate for different fire regimes, for different climate scenarios, and see how it will change, right? The ecosystem, the composition, and structure. That's one of the projects. But we are also now moving into more the emissions of fires because we've been researching much about how they impact the forest ecosystem, but not much on emissions because that's another problem with fires, right? It's carbon emissions. So last year we started a project on measuring emissions from fires, And also we engaged with the fire management institution, with the management institution of the reserve, and we're designing a fire management plan for the reserve. So those red areas in the map, those are the priority areas where we are developing specific activities to manage fires. So the others we don't really care about because it's a normal regime. The red areas are the ones that need some action. So basically this. So I don't think there's more questions. Shall we finish? Thank you.